go to Dr. Asa Hilliard, How to Study Kemite History. And the reason, this was done in Dallas, Texas, the 29th of April, 1991. The reason that he is doing this particular lecture, because when you study Egypt in most of these schools, high schools, junior high, and university colleges, community colleges, you primarily learn it from a European perspective, which makes the Europeans look as if they are the creators of the great sciences and art and math and so forth and so on. But there's an African perspective in which you should look at the Nile Valley studies, particularly Egypt, and if you want to name it properly, Kemet. So let's go to Dallas, Texas.
On our next speaker. He is the Fuller E. Calloway Professor of Urban Education at Georgia State University. He holds joint appointments in the Departments of Foundations, Early Childhood Education, and Counseling and Psychological Services. Our speaker is a former public school teacher and school psychologist. He has served as school superintendent in Liberia, West Africa, and as a former department chair and dean of education of San Francisco State University. Our speaker has worked and studied extensively in Africa, Europe, South America, the Caribbean, and the Pacific Islands. He has lectured at most of the major universities and colleges throughout this country. We know Asa G. Hilliard III. We are aware that he is a third-generation educator, one challenged by the obligation to prosper scholarship beyond that attained before him. We are aware that Dr. Hilliard has written, edited, and contributed a myriad of essays and articles for publication. Be reminded that it was he, many years ago, who wrote the introduction to Stolen Legacy. We also know that Dr. Hilliard has served as educational consultant to many public and quasi-public schools and service agencies throughout this nation. He was the primary catalyst in the successful establishment of African studies in the Portland school system. He has presented to both the Nile Valley and the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilization conferences. His resume is replete with achievements and awards. On behalf of the Third Eye and all the other conference participants, I present the prototype of dedication, scholarship, and consciousness. Please welcome Dr. Asa Hilliard.
African Family Hotep. I thank you for that introduction, and also to all of you for that very generous and warm welcome. I am thrilled to be a part of this presentation by Third Eye and commend and congratulate them for the work they've been doing, and hope that they may think about carrying this presentation, this sharing, all across this nation. Because clearly there is something growing, there is something that is developing, that is snowballing in the African consciousness within the family, and the attendance here today is definitely an indication of that. It's always good to have the opportunity to touch base with the giants of African intellectual thought and spiritual commitment, and certainly those who you have already heard, Dr. Ivan Van Sertima, Dr. Naeem Akbar, Noko Rashidi, and Brunson, and Sister Hardiman, and all others who are to come, and certainly Doc Ben, I can't wait to hear him again, are representative of a cluster of people who have taken leadership throughout the last decades now, and who are nothing more than symbols of what is about to happen, because one of the things that interests me is how many of our young people have taken up the fight, who have begun to read, who attend conferences, who are convening meetings, who are members of study groups to advance the kind of knowledge that has been developed. So I'm very pleased to have a small part in this program. My part is going to cover about four major points. Beg pardon? Oh, I thought you were having trouble hearing. Is anyone having trouble hearing? No, okay. My part is going to cover the following points. I'm going to have a brief slide presentation. Many of you here know that I enjoy showing more than telling, because sometimes the things that we say about African people are virtually unbelievable unless you actually see the evidence for yourself. And so for that reason, I want to deal with some things that are still on our minds clearly as I've listened to the presentations of other speakers. I want to present certain visual information to you, the part of what we have to do. Then in addressing this question of historiography in ancient Kemet, what has to be done, I want to suggest to you that there are 10 master keys for understanding ancient Kemet. 10 master keys. And I want to tell you what those are that help us to interpret the history of Kemet as an African civilization. And then, having presented those 10 master keys, I want to suggest, especially to the young people who are beginning to get into research on Kemet, and who will certainly in a short period of time eclipse those of us who have been working for an even longer period of time, and they will do that because they're going to be so much better prepared, in part because of what has been written, but because they are bringing to bear very refined research skills, modeling after some of our great teachers such as Dr. Ben, Dr. Shekanta Joff, and others. So what I want to do for them and also for all of us is to suggest 8 rules for searching about information about ancient Kemet. And I can do this because of all the mistakes that have been made in the study of ancient Kemet by most of those who have been funded to do that kind of research in the Western world, those in France, those in the United States. I'm going to start the presentation also with a type of calendar, a time chart, and also a list of the points that were made by Sheikh Anta Geoff explaining how we know that the ancient Kemites were in fact native African black people. I find that this is very important. It's important that for those who are new to this, that you not be found in your classrooms, in your casual conversation, having made a statement without the ability to go back and get the documentation to support that statement. And so for you to know that this documentation is overwhelming, I would like to present once again the summary of the points that make us know that the cultural attaché, as I guess that's what you could call him, who says that ancient Kemet was neither black nor white, it was Egyptian. You know, I went to kindergarten, and I never knew that in kindergarten Egyptian was a primary color. And it's probably true that there were some who were Egyptians, but I'm not talking about Egyptians, I'm talking about Kemetic people. And there is a difference between Kemet and Egypt. If you're talking Egypt, you're talking the present. If you're talking Kemet, you're talking the native African civilization, which occupied the territory that is now ancient, that is now new Egypt. So we will start then with the chart. And I hope I can get the light because it's... is it possible to dim the lights on the stage? You're going to have a hard time seeing it. Okay, I want you to keep this chart in mind. In fact, you ought to have a kind of chart like this in mind anytime you come to the study of ancient Kemet. You must keep things in chronological order. There is more confusion about the history of Kemet due to the fact that things are not kept or presented in chronological order than any other single thing. For example, if you go to the British Museum, the museum is not set up in chronological order. And you will have a piece in the British Museum from the 18th dynasty, right next to a piece from the Greco-Roman dynasties, which are down at dynasty 30 or 31. And that's a period that may span some 1,500 years. So side by side, you have two pieces and no way to interpret their temporal meaning. It is critical that a time chart be developed so that as you pick up information, you always make reference to where that belongs on your time chart. Those of you who were in Renoko Rashidi's presentation saw a very excellent use of a time sequence. And if you followed him, you will see that it parallels almost precisely this time chart. If you look at the right, you'll see an important piece of information. It says cultural Kemet, cultural Kemet. And you'll notice that that line goes from approximately 640 A.D. up to 3100 B.C., and it's pointed, which means it keeps going. What that means is that the culture of ancient Kemet is longer in time than 3,000 years. In fact, it goes back, if you believe Mer Injihuti, who the Greeks call Manito, it goes back some 20 to 30,000 years. But let's be conservative. The culture of the Nile Valley was intact and preserved as a culture distinctly Kemetic for almost 15 to 20,000 years. And so I'm only taking one small piece of that you see here, cultural Kemet, as that one line, to emphasize the fact that culturally the country never changed during the time that we're concerned with, during the period of Ramesses. We want to locate Ramesses where he belongs in order to know what his contributions mean. Notice right next to that, I have a line that says political Kemet. Political Kemet. And you'll notice that there are four colored squares or rectangles. Four colored rectangles. They represent the golden ages of ancient Kemet. It's very important to know where the high performance periods were for the culture. That is the those are the high tech periods, the high cultural development periods, the creative periods, and they also happen to be the periods during which native black Africans ruled. And I intend to show that in several ways, but one of the ways that I will show it is with the pictures. I've selected mainly the pictures of kings and queens from those first three periods. I will not get into the fourth period, but the first three periods, because those are sometimes contested. And I've selected only royalty from those periods, and I've only selected the royalty associated with the greatest achievements of the period. In other words, by showing clearly with the pictures and then later supporting that with the points that are made by Sheikh Anta Diop that teach us how we know that the ancient Kemites were black native African people, then we will be able to come to the conclusions and support those conclusions that we've been asserting for so long. You'll notice that in the first golden age, those of us who are in ASCAC, the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilization, prefer to call these golden ages, not kingdoms, not old kingdom, middle kingdom, new kingdom, and late period, which is what the professional Egyptologists prefer to call them. We prefer to call them golden ages. So that the first golden age is the primary pyramid age. And you see that is indicated with pyramids in the golden age box. Traditionally, that is called the old kingdom. And you'll notice that it is it runs from the third dynasty through the sixth dynasty. What you need to know is that all of the major pyramids were built then. All of them. There were a few minor pyramids that were built in the Middle Kingdom. But that's why we call this the Pyramid Age. All the great pyramids were built during that period. If you use this chart, you see something right away, which is that noticing the invasions down the side, the major invasions, that means invasions during which someone came in and spent a significant amount of time and penetrated significantly deeply into Kemet. You'll notice the time of the invasion. The first one that actually disturbs Kemet occurred around 1700 B.C. with the Hyksos. So the Hyksos come in after two golden ages. What that tells you is that no one helped African people build a single pyramid because all the pyramids were built before any significant foreign population ever entered the country of Kemet. The only way that they could have helped is if they had been there as visitors. But there was no significant population from Asia or anywhere else prior to the time of that first set of invasions by the Hyksos. You'll notice that the first golden age is followed by an intermediate period in traditional Egyptology. That's what they call it. It means simply a family squabble. The family couldn't keep it together. Shortly after that family squabble, we have dynasties 11 and 12. I'm going to show you the pharaohs from dynasties 3 through 6 who are important, and then 11 and 12 who are important. Because 11 and 12 was the flowering. Everyone agrees that 11 and 12 was the explosion of literature in the ancient Kemetic world. So that's when we began to get poetry, epic plays. That's when we began to get short stories. That's when we began to get the proverbs and so forth in fantastic numbers. And so we want you to pay special attention to that because I'm going to pull from that the three most important kings who were there. And then we have the breakdown of approximately 200 years between the second golden age or literary age. And there you see a gap between that orange block and the kind of reddish-orange block. And the reddish-orange block is the great grand golden age of Kemet. The great grand golden age of the 18th and 19th dynasties. Someone has already referred to the 18th dynasty as Le Grand Clegg's dynasty because he specializes in the study of that 18th dynasty. 18th dynasty is followed by the 19th, of course, which is the time of Ramesses II. What that also tells you from just looking at the chart is that Ramesses II comes in at the end of the third golden age, not at its beginning. So even though he is to be credited with massive amounts of building, there's almost no innovation in the time of Ramesses II. All the architectural forms had already been created. Religion had already been created. The kingship and government had already been created. The family structure had already been created. So that what we're talking about is a person who becomes important toward the end of the third golden age period. Then there is another gap, which is basically internal disunity again, some foreign invaders attempting to pepper away, followed by the last, as Dr. John Henry Clark said, the last walk in the sun for African people, the last time that black African people control the development of Kemet. And you'll see that that's called the fourth golden age. I call it the revival age. And you'll see why we call it the revival age in just a short period of time when I show you the pictures of the people who actually did the work during that period. Some Egyptologists call this the Ethiopian period. For most traditional Egyptologists, and I think there ought to be a distinction between Kemetologists and Egyptologists. Kemetologists are the people who are searching for the truth. You can see from this chart when Egypt starts. You don't have an Egypt and can't have an Egypt until you get some Greek people to call it Egypt. Because Egypt is a Greek word and not a Kemetic word at all. You will not find it in any of the writings anywhere. The only thing you will find referring to the name of the country is Kemet or Tameri. Tameri meaning the beloved land and Kemet meaning the black land. However, as Sheikh Anta Diop has shown, it also means the black people of the black land because the determinative that goes with that hieroglyph or Medu Netcher has a little man and a woman sitting side by side with a plural sign underneath them, meaning people and not dirt. So we have then this last golden age ending political Kemet, which means you have almost a 3,000-year period of native rule. Notice that the political line and the cultural line are different, which means even though there was a loss of political control after the 25th dynasty, which is the fourth golden age, there was a loss of political control to foreigners, specifically to Persians, which is the first invasion after the fourth golden age that was major. Then to Greeks, which is the next one. Then to Romans, which is next. Then to Vandals, after the time of Christ. Then to Arabs. And then, of course, European slavery and colonization are way down at the end of the chart. So that you'll notice that in spite of the fact that we had been under control of foreigners in Kemet up through the time of the Vandals, it is not until the time of the Arabs after Muhammad that the culture of the country begins to change. That the people still acted the same way when the Greeks were there and when the Romans were there. In fact, the way they acted was the model for Greece and for Rome. Greek and Roman people came in copying African people. Even though they were their political bosses, they were their cultural inferiors. That's the part that you need to keep in mind. Because you had 3,000 years of cultural traditions that manifest themselves in such an overpowering way that the whole of the European world was shaped or misshapen by them. It was shaped to the extent that they understood the African tradition. It was misshapen to the extent that they did not understand it at all, which was to a large degree. Then we have, just for your information, on this chart we have the University of Sankore at Timbuktu, which is down here. It begins, for those of you who can see to take notes, it begins about 1100 A.D., and it ends somewhere in the 1800s. It peaks around 1600 A.D. You might be wondering, why is it that we include information about Sankore University in a talk about ancient Kemet? We must remember that there is a cultural connection between the west of Africa and the south of Africa and the northeast corner of Africa, that these things are culturally unified. Now, I'd like to taking this chart then, move to the 10 master keys before I show the actual photographs of some of the rulers. 10 master keys to approaching the interpretation of the data on ancient Kemet. Master key number one, in reading or listening to presentations about Kemet, we must remember cultural antiquity and continuity start in pre-dynastic times and go to 640 A.D. That's the very first key. We must remember that we're talking about a cultural tradition that is lost in antiquity. As it has been said sometime, by the time we see what we call Egypt, that whole country is already old and gray, culturally speaking. Why do I say that? Example, the calendar is already in place before the first dynasty. 4236 B.C. approximately for the beginning of the calendar, minimum. In all probability, it is much older than that, which suggests, not only suggests, but almost dictates that someone was watching stars and sun for thousands of years in order to know what the cycles were so that they could base a calendar on those cycles. So if you know that the calendar was being used 4,000 years B.C., which is before 3100 B.C. when this chart starts, then you know that you already have a science of astronomy in place. So that's a long time for that cultural, that scientific aspect of culture to be in operation. Secondly, the Medunetcher, or the writing system of Kemet, which is called hieroglyphics, was already in place and fully developed at 3100 B.C. It's pre-pyramidal. The Medunetcher was already in place 3100 B.C. and fully developed. That's the important thing, a writing system that didn't get started with the first pharaoh. So it is wrong to say that the pharaoh who united the two lands was the one that started the culture. African people's culture had taken thousands of years to develop, and it was the culture that made the two lands ready for unity. Asar and Heru, Osiris and Horus were already in place 3100 years B.C., in other words, the theological system, which is the central theological system that remains the same through 3,000 years, is already there. So that's what we mean by cultural antiquity and continuity beginning from pre-dynastic times up to the present. The form of the family was already matrifocal. The concept of the kingship, the particular system of governance that was typical throughout the pharaonic period, was already in place 3100 B.C. And much more could be said, but what I'm saying is, so far, key number one is that any time we approach the study of Kemet, we must know that when we're looking at the natural culture, We're looking at an ancient culture. Whether we're talking dynasties 25, 12, 3, or what have you. Even if we're talking the dynasties after the invasions of the Greeks and Romans, even the foreign dynasties, that would still be true. The second key, master key, if you will, to the interpretation of the culture and development of Kemet is older is better. That the oldest material, culturally speaking, is the best material. Example, the Medu Neter is best when it is oldest, especially in terms of its art. You begin to see this, for example, if you look at the writing system of the ancient Kemites in the Pyramid Age, the writing is absolutely beautiful. Relief carving, bas-relief, the paintings, care is taken. Not only that, but what is said is absolutely beautiful. By the time you get to the time of Ramesses II in particular, you have a deterioration. People don't take time with the writing anymore. His father, Seti I, was very instrumental in producing temples that followed the old form. But if you go to the temple of Seti I at Abydos, or Abdu, which was finished by his son Ramesses, you can see in the part that's tacked on to Seti I's temple a complete change in the quality of the artwork in the presentation of the writing. Because the old writing, in other words, the old culture, is always the best. For those people who know me, you might know that, for example, there's a three-volume set of the ancient Kemetic literature by Miriam Lichtheim, an anthology of what was written in the Old Kingdom, what was written in the Middle Kingdom, and then what was written in the New Kingdom, and what was written in the late period. It's very important to get those volumes. But compare Book 1 with Book 3, and read the writing, read the text themselves, and see whether or not older is not better. When you read the Old Kingdom literature, it is much more pure in form. It is much more spiritual. It is much less magical. There is no pornography, for example, in the Old Kingdom literature. You get pornography by the time you get to the Greeks. Go to the Temple of Dendera. Look in the ceiling where you have the zodiac. Look around the ceiling, and you'll see pornography around the ceiling of the temple, coming from the Greco-Roman restoration of the Temple of Dendera. You will not find that in the temples during the Pyramid Age, for example. So older is better. The pyramid architecture is better the older it is. So that the first pyramids were the best pyramids. Those on the Giza Plateau are better than the ones that were built afterwards. Most of the pyramids that were built after Khufu's pyramid aren't even standing.
KPFK, Los Angeles.
In many cases, they are piles of rubble. For some reason, people lost the technology, they lost the interest, they lost the discipline, and they did not do the same kind of job. So generally speaking, then, a second key that we have to add to the first, which is cultural continuity, unbroken culture for more than 3,000 years, perhaps 15,000 years. And secondly, the master key is that if you're looking for something to be good, you probably should be looking in the old dynasties, not in the new ones. Notice now, if we talk about Greeks and Romans, what dynasty are we talking about? They really shouldn't be called a dynasty at all because they are foreign rule, not native rule. But if we want to call them Dynasty 30 or 31, if you were to look for what they produced, it will be worse than what had been produced before. Master key number three, the orientation, the entire cultural orientation of the ancient Kemites was southern. The entire orientation was southern. In other words, the whole country was oriented to the south. At the Kemetic Institute in Chicago, they have produced maps that will show this southern orientation the way the ancient Kemites would have portrayed it. For the ancient Kemites, the word face and the word south are identical. The word left and the word west, left and the word east are identical. The word right and the word west are identical, and the word for the back of the head and north are identical. So there are, in their language, their orientation is to the south. Those of you who heard Runoko Rashidi's publication noticed that he pointed out that one of the characteristics of every king of Kemet, one of the goals that they had was to get an expedition to the south, to the Holy Land, to Punt, to the nation that we now call Somaliland. That would be Punt on the map. Everybody wanted to get up to Punt, and there are records of many pharaohs taking actual expeditions, and one of the most famous expeditions to Punt was the one in the 18th dynastic period, the third golden age by Hatshepsut. She wanted to go to Punt because that was God's land. That was a synonym for Punt. She wanted to pick up the plants from Punt. She wanted to pick up carvings, incense, and other things that came from God's land and put those things in the valley where her temple was built so that she could build for God a Punt in Kemet. Notice, at no time did any pharaoh ever talk about building Syria in Kemet. They never said anything about building Persia in Kemet. They never talked about building Greece in Kemet. The only time that you will see them talking about building something outside the country, in the country, is to go deep into the land of the ancestors, so that whenever they spoke of where they came from, their records are clear in identifying them with a southern origin. So the third master key for understanding Kemet, if you were trying to interpret cultural material, the worst thing you could do, let's say you're trying to interpret language, the worst thing you can do is to go study the Syrian language, so-called Semitic languages, because the Kemetic language is not a Semitic language. You would study the languages with which it had genetic kinship. Fourth, the fourth master key is that the origin of the Kemites themselves is southern. In other words, not only was their orientation southern, which means they looked back to the place from which they had come, but they themselves had come from that place towards which they looked back, according to their own records and their own words. And then fifth, leadership is southern. I hope you picked up that point if you were in Renoko Rashidi's workshop again. The leadership always comes from the south. I'm talking about the main kings who ruled Kemet were always southern. Every king, for example, who was in the dynastic period, and let's take the founding of the period. Let's go up here to Dynasty 1. Dynasty 1 is founded by Mina. Mina's activities are centered at Abydos, not at Cairo. Let's go to the pyramid age of Abdu. Those pyramid age pharaohs generally tended to have their tombs and their funerary exercises back up in the interior of the country. Even when they would have something near Saqqara or Menefer, Memphis, they would also have something back at Abydos. Let's look at the literary age, Dynasty 11 and 12. That is when they physically moved the center of government to the middle of the country, to a city called Waset, today called Luxor, called by the Greeks Thebes. Let's look at the imperial age, which is the third golden age. That is where the center of government was at Waset. The liberation pharaoh came from the south. His name was Sekhenenre. He was a part of a Waset family. They were the ones that kicked the Asians out of Kemet and pushed them back to the north. So the liberation of the country proceeded from the south and remained in the south throughout the whole of the great, grand, glorious golden age of the 18th dynastic period. I've labeled that period the imperial period. But it's a different kind of imperialism. It's a protective imperialism. Ancient Kemetic people were not interested in going into other people's countries and building monuments and temples and tombs. They had all they needed at home. All they wanted was to be left alone. That's what they did. When they were left alone, they built brilliantly, both in cultural and in material terms. And so in the Great Golden Age, which we call the Imperial Age, it can be called that, but it needs to be called that with a qualification. The qualification that we understand, it was primarily defensive. It was after 200 years of humiliation that they mounted this imperial warlike posture toward the outside world, but it was located in the south. What about the Restoration Age, that fourth golden age there? And you will see the kings and queens from that period. I don't have the pictures of the queens with me at this point. But from that period, again, the Restoration Age was led from the city of Waset. and the city of Meroe. So the Meroitic people up near Sudan, up near Khartoum, and the family located in Kemet at Waset or Luxor, this was the center of the family that ruled during the 25th Golden Age. So what we've got then, if we look at this chart, is a way to pinpoint, first, where all the big activity took place. That was in those colored blocks that you see there. And every time you see a colored block, the leadership comes from the south. So that's key number five. Origin is southern, is key number four. Leadership is southern, is key number five. Key number seven. Number six. Then I only got nine keys. Key number six. My number seven. All invasions were destructive. All invasions were destructive. Not once, with the possible exception of the Greeks, can you say that an invader contributed to building anything in the country. In other words, when the Hyksos came in, they tore it up and they left nothing behind. When, after the Hyksos, the Persians came in, they left nothing behind. There are no monuments that you can find that mean anything that were left by the Persian invaders. When the Greeks came in, there's a little exception. The Waset priesthood. This is how we know that cultural Kemet was still strong. Here you have Europeans who are supposed to be the pharaohs, but these Europeans have to deal with the Waset priesthood. They have to go up and get the cooperation of the Waset priesthood or they can't rule. The price that the Waset priesthood requires for its partial cooperation is that the Greeks must now take money out of the treasury and do an urban renewal program on the Nile. They have to come back to the temples and rebuild them. And so now when you go to Kemet, you can go to the temple at Luxor or Waset and look at the temple of Luxor or the southern Epet, as it should be called, and you will see an original temple. You can go to Karnak Temple, which is the temple of Ipet Isut, you will see an original temple. But if you look at the temple of Horus at Edfu, that is a recreated temple. When you go to Dendera, that is a Greco-Roman restoration. So that you have to know which temple you're in. It's very important to know whether you're in the original temple or whether you're in one that just got built yesterday with the Greeks and the Romans. Now notice, I'm not saying that the Greeks and the Romans built a single temple. They didn't. The Kemetic people built all the temples, but the Greeks and the Romans financed the reconstruction during the time of their rule, and as a favor to them, I suppose, after they did that, you now begin to see for the first time on those temples pictures and images that look like Greek and Roman people. See, now this is why you need a time chart. Because if you see some temples, they do have faces that look European on them. But you have to ask, when were these temples built? And then, if you go back and line up your images the way I'm going to line them up for you, when I show you these images lined up in order, the argument is over. You see? So key number six. All invasions were destructive. In other words, no one donated culture to Kemetic people. No one donated culture to Kemetic people. The most that you can say about donations of culture, in order to be fair, is that during the imperial period, for the first time, the Kemetic people in Dynasty 18 and 19 adopted the horse and the chariot, which had been in use in the Middle East as an implement of warfare. That is the only innovation that we find of significance adopted from the outside. But there's even question as to whether you can say that was from the outside, because we can find horses and chariots out in the some of the rock carvings that some people have suggested may even have predated the 18th dynastic period. I'm not sure about that, so I'm not going to push it too hard. But I'm just saying, if there is a contribution, that is the only contribution. So all invasions were destructive, so that even the contribution that was made was a destructive contribution. They did not give them God. They did not give them morality. They did not show them how to build temples. They did not build universities. In fact, the people say that the Hyksos who came in 1700 B.C. were so little in terms of cultural creativity that it's hardly possible to even find out that they were in the country. They left nothing behind. Literally nothing behind. Notice also, just for those of you who are into your Bible history, the Hyksos period is the period of some of your early Bible history, isn't it? Isn't that the period when, according to biblical historians, Abraham was supposed to have come into Egypt, and that would have been the first Hebrew family. He was supposed to have come from Ur of the Chaldees, and he had 70 people with him in his 12 families, who grew over 400 years, according to the story of the Exodus, to the point where they leave with Moses with at least 500,000 people living with him. No record of having brought a religion in. No record of any culture having been brought in. However, when they left, they had the same culture that they took out, that they had found there when they got there. They found monotheism there and took that out with them. They found the Bible there and took that out with them. Because we can go to the tomb of Unas and find the early versions of the book of coming forth from darkness into light, the Perim Ru, on the walls carved in stone. That is where you find the tablets of stone. You say, they're still there. Where are the other tablets of stone? Master key number 7, my number 8. Arabic migration mixes with Nubian people in the Kemetic Valley at and after the time of Muhammad. Let me say it again. Arabic people come in from Syria and Assyria in large numbers for the first time as the first large population of settlers after Muhammad. And they come in. And with Islam, you have the first change in the fundamental culture of Kemet. So that's why this line, culture Kemet, ends right around the time of the activity of the prophet. After that, now we have a mixed culture and a mixed people. See, this is why your culture attaché is all confused from Egypt today. He doesn't know when his people got there. This is when they got there. So I don't want us not to know when they got there, you see? And even though they got there, they never moved all the Nubians out. If you go to Kemet today, all you got to do is walk around Cairo 5 minutes and you're going to see as many people in Cairo who look just like this audience here as you'll see almost anywhere else in the country. However, once you leave Cairo, you suddenly see a browning of the population as soon as you move to Luxor. And by the time you get to Aswan, you are totally home. This is after 2,000 years of mixing. What color the present-day Kemetic people are, or Egyptian people are, I have at least one picture I'm going to end on that I will show you what color they are and why they are that color. Number 9. Number 8, right? My number 9. Your number 8. Or what number is it? Next number. The next key. Science. This is a very important one if you want to understand what was happening in the Nile Valley. Science generated religion. Let me say it again. Science generated religion. People didn't get religion just by looking up in the air and waiting for something to descend on their head. They got religion because they found God studying aspects of nature, which, as Dr. Akbar so eloquently showed, represented God no matter where you look. If you look at any part of nature, systematically, you see God. That's what Dr. Akbar told us. So the ancient Kemites, if they spent thousands of years looking at stars, saw behind the stars a divine imperative. If they spent the same number of thousands of years looking at fish, they saw behind the fish a divine imperative. If you looked at things animate and inanimate, and you keep seeing the same rules repeated over and over in nature, it suddenly occurs to you that there's something bigger than all of this that I can't grasp hold of yet. And you work yourself through study into religion. I'm saying this because a whole lot of people think you can be religious today without study. You don't have to look at nothing. Notice that science generated religion, but the religion that it generated is the same religion that other people borrowed without study. Whether they happen to be Buddhist, whether they happen to be Hebrew, whether they happen to be Christian, whether they happen to be Islam, they got the same religion from the source in Africa, and most cases they borrowed it without doing the homework. So science generated religion, it generated philosophy, and I might add, as important, it generated general culture. In other words, the way people lived their lives was a total way of life. Religion was not Sunday. Religion was every day from sun up to sunset and even while you were sleeping. So science produced a belief in the Creator and all the forces associated with the Creator, a philosophy and way of life in general, and a general culture that was totally religious. Where else in the world do you have a whole string of pharaohs whose total mission was dedicated to building for eternity, reflected in their very names? As you begin to hear the names of the pharaohs, they're all identifying with some aspect or power of God. So that science generated religion because you could never separate science from religion. Number last. The master key, the final master key to the interpretation of Kemetic culture is that there is no dualism in Kemetic culture. No dualism. Dualism in interpretation philosophically or culturally is a Western phenomenon. People like Kierkegaard. It's got to be either this or that. The African people say, no, it doesn't. It can be both this and that. You see? That's not a dualism. So how do you see it manifest? You don't have in commit a split between the scientist and the priest, because the priest was a scientist. See, when you go to Waset, the university still stands there today. The temple is called Epet Isut. You call it Karnak. Down the road is the temple of Luxor, which should be called the Southern Epet. That was a part of a university complex which housed some 80,000 students with a faculty that governed the priesthood. That governed the kingship. Listen to this. Pharaoh had to pay dues to the priest. Because if Pharaoh didn't do right, priesthood had lots of ways of taking care of Pharaoh. For one thing, he had to run every 30 years in the Hebsed feast. And to show he was still big and bad, all this was done behind a fence. And the only people who were the witnesses were the priests. What if they went outside and told the people, you know, he was around there running, trying to chase the bull, but this year he didn't make it. Then you don't have Pharaoh anymore. That's just one way that the Pharaohs had to make peace with the priests. The priests were the ones that were important. Philosopher kings. Remember when Plato's going to come over here right after, remember his teacher was Socrates, who came over and studied, and they made him drink poison because they didn't want him bringing those Egyptian ideas into Greece. Then his little boy, Plato, came over and studied for 22 years. And when he went back, Plato took this idea that had been created in Kemet about these powerful priests. You read it in the Republic, you just didn't know that that's what you were reading. In the Republic, you read about philosopher kings. That's what Plato wanted to do. He wanted the philosophers to rule in Greece. They never did. because they didn't like Plato any more than they liked his teacher. So they exiled Plato. Philosophy, Socrates had to drink poison. Plato had to get his hat. Plato's student Aristotle had to get his whole school up out of Greece and take it over to Africa in order to have an academic and intellectually sophisticated environment within which to work. So that the priesthood was the model. This is where that model came from. There was no dualism, no split between the person who was seeking truth through one means and a person who was seeking truth through another. No split between science and religion. Only in the West do you have this big split that's still going on. That's why I'm not a Jehovah's Witness, but I admire the Jehovah's Witness. They got this little two publications. They got a watchtower and they got an awake. So at least part of the time they're trying to look at the real world so that they can make the spiritual world make some kind of sense. There's no split in ancient Kemet between the sacred and the secular. That would be a dualism. Everything is sacred. Nothing is secular. In the West, there's a huge split between the sacred and the secular, and almost nothing is sacred. In Kemet, there is no split between the incast and the outcast. You will see at least one person in this list of pictures that I'm going to show you who rose up from the bottom to become the president of the University of Ipetisut. His name, Amenhotep, son of Hapu, and they referred to him, as they did to many others who rose in the hierarchy, as commoners. Because all you had to do in this open admission school system was work hard. And if you work hard, then you were entitled to the fruits of your labor, regardless of your social class. So there's no incast and outcast. That comes to us from the North. There's no separation between church and state. There's no separation between school, science, and religion. There's no separation between the aesthetic and the functional. I know brothers right now that can't hardly get their heads together being trained in Western art school. Because they're taught that if something is functional, it can't be art. See, it can only be art if it doesn't have anything to do with anything. That's anti-African. It's nothing. If it doesn't have anything to do with anything, why are you doing it? See? So all the art, remember I said, one of the keys, the older you get, the better it is. So the further back you go, the less you will find anybody just doodling for art. Anything that they put down had a divine imperative because it was supposed to exist as a living symbol. You didn't just draw ankhs for jewelry. The ankh is supposed to awaken in your imagination an identity with the eternal living force of the Creator. It's not just jewelry. So those are the master keys in the study of ancient Kemet. Let me say something about the rules that we should follow in searching so that we don't get confused like this poor little person did, who they call a cultural attaché from Egypt. To search for the truth in ancient Kemet, rule number one, organize your data in chronological order. I'm really reemphasizing that for the benefit of the young people who are just getting into this. If you're studying and reading, set up your chart this way. Know where you are anytime you're reading a piece of literature. Know whether you're reading a Middle Kingdom piece of literature or an Old Kingdom piece of literature or a New Kingdom piece of literature or a Greco-Roman piece of literature, because it makes all the difference in the world. Secondly, make sure you always use the Kemetic names. Never use the foreign names for Kemetic reality. Don't use foreign names for Kemetic towns. Don't use foreign names for Kemetic people, because the names contain as much of the history as the texts that are written beside the name. If the Pharaoh tells you that his name is Ka, Af, Re, you can't just simply turn that into Sephrin or Kephrin, because if you do, Kephrin has no meaning. But Ka, Af, Re, the word Ka means soul. The letter F means his, and then the word Re means God. So here's the Pharaoh who named himself saying, his soul manifests God. And you're going to change his name to Sephiroth. That's what the Greeks did, you know. How are you going to take the name of the city of Wasit and change it to Thebes, which means nothing, and later to Luxor, which is a mistake? Luxor means the palaces. The Arabs who came there thought they were looking, when they looked at the temples, they thought that was where the king lived. They got it upside down. You can't find a palace in Kemet. All the pharaohs they had, hundreds of pharaohs, no palaces. You can't find their house. They don't live. They don't exist. What they built for eternity was their temples and their tombs. So what the Arabs thought ought to have been the place where the king lived. Anything that's splendid must have been the house where the king lived. So they called it Luxor, El Luxor, the palaces, when in fact it was Wasit, not El Luxor and not Thebes. Wasit meaning the scepter, the center of spiritual power in the whole of the Kemetic world. Look at this now. In Dynasty 18, that was when Kemet ruled the world. 4 million people in the nation of Kemet in the third golden age. 1 million people in the city of Waset, the largest city in the ancient world. 800,000 men in the army, the largest army in the whole world at that time. The envy of every city on the planet that was anywhere in the neighborhood. That was what Waset was. Now, don't go calling it Thebes, and don't go calling it Luxor. Call it by its own name. Keep the names correct, or you will miss data for interpreting the meaning of what you're looking at. Number three. Some people get all confused, especially on this black-white thing. Because you'll go up to Abu Simbel, and on one side as you go into the temple of Abu Simbel, there will be some people who are captives with their hands tied behind them, and they're obviously black people. So they automatically say, well, you see, these... Now, when you see black people, they're prisoners and slaves. No, when you saw those black people, they were prisoners and slaves. You can go right over on the other side of the temple of Abu Simbel, and you'll see Arabs who are prisoners and slaves. Usually when people show the black, they never show the Arabs. In other words, those were people who represented those who had been conquered in foreign lands. But let's take a look at this now. Why would you always compare the captive to the priest or the pharaoh? Compare the captive to someone who was not at his level. In other words, if you're trying to use your imagination and interpret the images that you have, why not start off and say, well, I'm going to look only at holy images. And then come back and say, now I'm only going to look at royal images. And then later say, I'm only going to look at images of the common people. That way you'll be able to keep your images straight. Because when you do, see, that's what I've done for you, and we'll show you right now, which is I've restricted myself only to the royal images. I've even left out the holy images. If I put the holy images in, you would see they were all black too. But because of the time available, I'm only showing you royal images, only three golden ages. Okay? Only three golden ages. So then let's go on. The next rule. Look for activity in the peak periods, not in the intermediate periods. Pay attention to the peak periods. People will mislead you. The Greco-Roman period was not a peak period. Supposed to be an Egyptian exhibit at Emory University. And when the Black Arts Festival was in Atlanta, they asked me to lecture over at Emory University. And then afterwards, we were going to go into the Egyptian exhibit that they had there. And I already knew before we went that they did not have an Egyptian exhibit. They still don't have an Egyptian exhibit. They advertise an Egyptian exhibit, but there is no Egyptian exhibit. What they have are some mummies of the Greco-Romans. They have some pictures of the Greco... In other words, any image that they had was of a Greek or Roman person. They didn't have one image of anybody from any of those four golden ages. Not one. And I told them, I said, I bet you if you got anything from the 18th dynasty or the 12th dynasty or the third dynasty, it's a piece of pottery and probably broken. And that's what they had. So don't call it a Kemetic exhibit. It isn't. It's a Greco-Roman exhibit. Because you didn't look at Kemet during the peak period. In other words, I want to see what you have for the peak period. Watch yourself when you go to Cairo. If you don't go on one of the right tours, when you get to the Kemetic Museum, they will the first thing they'll tell you is that we may not have time for the 25th dynasty. But they got time for the 30th. They will tell you that they're going to look at the dynasty 18, but they're not going to show you anybody but King Tut. What about King Tut's mother? And King Tut's father. You see, those are important too. And they almost never show you the kings, the ones that I'm getting ready to show you, of the 11th and 12th dynasties. And you'll see why in just a second. The next rule. Separate your native people from your foreign people. Separate your native people from your foreign people. The next rule. Don't pick pieces of information and treat them in isolation. Put them in context. I will try to give you one quick demonstration of that. Be comprehensive and contextual when you treat this information. 7, remember the fact of cultural unity. And 8, in whatever investigation you do in order to avoid the mistakes of the past, wherever possible, use multidisciplinary, multinational teams. See, one of the reasons for all the lies about Kemet is that virtually nobody but white Europeans got to do the studies. So naturally, they saw what they wanted to see. What happened when they got to Cairo at the point where Sheikh Anta Diop had challenged them to look closely, when they got to Cairo, they couldn't defend themselves in 1984. This little cultural attaché man apparently didn't know that they had already had to debate and settle it in 1974. About the origin of the ancient Egyptian under the auspices of UNESCO. You get a different answer when you're on neutral territory than you do when you're in your own living room, you see? And so those questions have been answered in the living rooms of these scientists before rather than on neutral territory. When they got on neutral territory, they could not defend themselves. Well, let's take a quick look then. Okay, just before I share the pictures with you, this is a summary, and again, for those who are somewhat new to this area, if you've been studying ancient Kemet for any time at all, I know you already know that there is a master source on this, which is Dr. Van Sertima's book, Great African Thinkers. You need it. If you don't get any other book, you need that one. There's also a book called The Peopling of Ancient Egypt and the Deciphering of the Meroitic Script, which was done based on the debate in Cairo about who were the ancient Kemetic people. Briefly then, there are 11 ways which overwhelmingly show that the ancient Kemetic people were black African people. 11 ways, not one. 11 ways, quickly. Evidence from physical anthropology. This is looking at pre-dynastic skulls. 2, evidence from Kemetic human images, as I will show in just a moment. 3, testing the skin of mummies for melanin content. This is the challenge that nobody has picked up, that Sheikh Anta Diop gave out. And after he gave it out, the mummies disappeared from the Cairo Museum and have never shown up again. And he told you how to do it, too. It's in the book. I'm not going to take time. Osteological measures. This is skeletal comparisons. Blood group. Sheikh Anta Diop showed that the blood, whenever you could determine the blood of the bodies of the Kemites, their blood group was almost invariably B, but European blood is almost invariably A. The testimony, all the Greek scholars and Roman scholars who ever described the Kemites who were eyewitnesses were unified in calling them black people. None of them who saw them ever called them white people. You won't find it in their literature. The Kemetic self-description, they call themselves black people. In fact, that was the name of their country. Divine epithet. All their gods were black. Evidence from the Bible. They are the children of Ham, remember? Kemet, Punt, Cush, and Palestine. Okay, don't Canaan. Canaan is Palestine. Mizraim is Kemet. Cush is Ethiopia. And Punt is Somaliland. Those are Ham's children. And just by the way, one of Ham's children also founded Babylon, which made Ham's grandson the founder of Babylon. That was Nimrod. One of Ham's children, who was Cush, begat Nimrod. And Nimrod was the founder of Babylon. So clearly these are black people, if Ham was black, according to the biblical story. And then the cultural unity with the rest of Africa, which is beautifully argued by Sheikh Atta Diop. And finally, the linguistic unity with more southern and western Africa. If these are all the elements of proof fully discussed in the book, Peopling. This is, I guess what I'm asking you to do is please buy this book. I wish you would buy UNESCO out, because this is the record of the actual debate with people who were supposed to have come prepared, who got their behinds whipped in Cairo under the UNESCO's supervision. Of course, if it hadn't been under their supervision, they'd have been whipped even more. Okay, so those are two sources that you should have. You should have Sheikh Atta Diop's life work summarized in Great African Thinkers, and you should have the UNESCO General History of Africa volume number 2, or the book from UNESCO, Peopling of Ancient Egypt, Deciphering of the Meroitic Script. Okay, let me conclude then with a brief tour through royalty by dynastic period. Taking it first, from something that I believe is pre-dynastic, but they want to call this Ka-Af-Re. They say that's the pharaoh. John Jackson argues that this is older than all the pharaohs and all the pyramids and all of Kemet, and takes it back to about 10,000 years ago. And that's called by the Greeks the Sphinx, by the Africans Horemaket. Side view of that by Baron Dinan, who was a professor with Napoleon. Side view by Nikon 2 years ago. Clearly, if you get a profile on Horemaket or the Sphinx or whatever else you want to call him, you have nothing but a stone brother. And, of course, you get copies. You can have the real, or you can have a reasonable facsimile. Okay, now, that's a quick pre-dynastic, or as I call it, pre-dynastic. Now we go into the pyramid age. Very quickly, just before the pyramid. This is the unification of the two lands with Mena. Some of you saw this picture before. Clearly an African. Zoser. I have two shots of Zoser. Here's another one of him in the Cairo Museum. Clearly an African. He's in the first golden age. He is the first person to have a pyramid. He is the one who built the step pyramid here, this rock, the first building in rock. And it's unfortunate I don't have the whole temple complex to share with you, because it is something that would look good right now if we just put it down in downtown Dallas right here. That's the step pyramid of Zoser. The first pyramid, not the first true pyramid. His designer of that pyramid, Imhotep, father of medicine and also architect, we'll could say a lot more about him, but we'll let it go. Here's one you probably have not seen. This is Seneferu, who is the builder of the first true pyramid. This is a statue of Seneferu found in the museum in Paris, the Louvre Museum in Paris. Seneferu, clearly an African who built the first true pyramid. This is his son, Khufu, who built the Great Pyramid. So whatever doubts there may be about Khufu, there's none about Seneferu, his daddy. Okay? So this is Khufu, who built the Great Pyramid, and that three-pyramid complex in Giza, you already know. The Great Pyramid in the background. Khafre's pyramid in the center. Menkaure's pyramid as third. So here is the kind of pyramid, though, that the West can build. Because they tell me Dr. Van Sertima talked a little bit about the Japanese and wasn't too kind to them last night about their level of capability in terms of technology. And I fully agree. But they're trying to... See, that's the pyramid they tried to build in Kemet, and the Egyptian government made them tear it down as a monstrosity. That's with all the high tech. They couldn't build one. Well, now they found a pyramid they can build, and this is in the New York Times in New York City. The pyramid that they're going to build is going to be bigger than the Grand Pyramid of Khufu. A garbage dump. That's the pyramid that we're going to build in the West. It's being built right now outside New York City. It's just a big garbage dump. But we still have our rock pyramid standing from the great golden age. Okay, I have to go past this because it deserves some talk, because I think this is as impressive as the pyramid. This particular boat of Khufu, showing the level of maritime technology available at the same time as the pyramid. In other words, ocean-going vessels. And the father of Khufu put 40 of these into the Mediterranean and went to Lebanon. 40 of them. That's a fleet. That's called a navy in anybody's nation. And this is long before you had the first Phoenician set foot on the ground, even as an image in somebody's eye. So here is Khafre, the builder of the second pyramid, clearly an African. Here is Menkaure, the builder of the third pyramid in Giza, clearly an African. Here's Menkaure again, clearly an African. Now, I put this one in because if you pick up a book on Kemet, this is what you're going to see, along with Nefertiti, fake Nefertiti. You'll see fake Nefertiti and this scribe Kai. And you'll see them because they tend to look Caucasian. You won't see any of the pictures that I've been showing you, who are kings, but you will see secretaries and foreigners, okay? Okay, that's where we find the Book of the Dead, going past that. Pepe II, this is 6th dynasty. Up in Aswan, there's a whole bunch of rock tombs that were the tombs that actually started that form of tomb architecture, which would later be built in the Valley of the Kings. When you get inside these rock tombs at Aswan, the pharaohs are black. They also got, I put this in because they got elephants in the hieroglyphic. People used to say they don't have any elephants in the hieroglyphic. They wonder how that could be if this is African people. They use everything around them. Elephants were around them. Where are the elephants? Well, you see now they got elephants in the hieroglyphic. What you don't see is camels in the hieroglyphic. Camels are Asians, and they are imported. So every time you see a pyramid and a camel on the pack of cigarettes, that's a late comer to Kemet. Okay, let's go quickly then to the three kings of the second golden age, the literary age. Who were these people? Who was leading these writing people? Well, first you had Mentahotep II, who founded the dynasty. That's why I picked him. Actually, there were some Intef pharaohs that got this thing going, but the real founder of the dynasty was Mentahotep. And then in the 12th dynasty, that was Dynasty 11. Dynasty 12, two pharaohs I'm going to show you, because they're the two most important. This is Khepre-Kaure Senwosret I. According to Martin Bernal's book, Black Athena, this is the pharaoh who founded the Greek city-state of Athens. Now, don't you think that people who were interested in the truth might at least put this up as a hypothesis? You know, if we got the picture of the pharaoh, you don't find him anywhere in any of the books. He's in the Cairo Museum, but nobody ever talks about him if you get on the wrong tour. Khepre-Kaure, clearly an African, founder of Athens, temple built to him, becomes Karnak Temple 500 years later, becomes the center for 80,000 students on the east bank of the Nile. Then the second pharaoh of the 12th dynasty that I wanted to show you, Imenemet, who gets identified as Memnon, same pharaoh here, Memnon, who to the Greeks was the Memnon who fought Agamemnon. They were the ones named him Memnon. They changed his name from Imenemet to Memnon, who fought at Troy with Agamemnon and got killed at Troy. This was the Ethiopian general who brought a bunch of Ethiopians to fight at Troy, but you never see them in Hollywood. Okay, here's the family portrait. Remember I said one of the principles is to put everything in context. You know, every now and then just group the family together so you can see what they all look like. And you'll see that the same rules apply. Amenemhat I, Amenemhat II, Sin was Ret Kepricare the first, and Amenemhat the third. Okay, lastly, we're going to look quickly then at the 18th dynasty, and then I'll let you go. To start the 18th dynasty, we got mummies. We got the mummy of Second Inre. Now, again, since this is an audience that wants a little more technical information, you must get the book. Get the book, X-Ray Atlas of the Royal Mummies, published by the University of Chicago, so you can see the mummies. They have pictures of the mummies. You just haven't seen them anywhere. They're too busy showing you fake Nefertiti. Because if you see the mummies, you see they're all black. Here's the mummy of Second Inre, with a hole in his head, apparently killed in battle, who started the War of Liberation. He was the 18th dynasty Garvey, actually 17th dynasty. Liberation. Here is the queen mother of that dynasty, Nefertari, not Nefertiti. No necklaces done to Nefertari. Everybody's got gold necklaces of fake Nefertiti. Nefertari and her son Amenhotep the first. Then mummies. Remember I told you, you can find the mummies if you look hard. These are the mummies that went underground in Cairo. You can't see them anymore. You have to get this book, and you have to turn to the back of the book. Don't be like some people who read books and stop with the first chapter. You will never see the mummies in that book. You have to go all the way back to the very last page because they're stuck in a little pocket on microfiche. Then you have to go down to the library and get yourself a microfiche reader so that you can blow these things up so that you can see them like I did. If you look over here in the corner, you can see the index number from the microfiche. That's how I got the figures. You really got to work hard to see your ancestors. Okay, this is Thutmose the first. Jehudimez the first. Let me say it in the African way. Thutmose, you know, that's the Greeks call him Thoth, you know. His name should be Jehudimez. You remember, everybody in the 18th dynasty just about was called Mez something, which means Moses, M-S. So Moses was a very common name. So the biblical Moses was only half a name, right? Because you're supposed to be the child of something. Mez just means born of. Born of what? This man's born of wisdom. Jehudimez the first. Okay? Then Jehudimez the second. Now do you see why Sheikh Abdul Diab demanded a melanin test? The Hatshepsut statue and Hatshepsut's temple, the architect for the temple, Senemut, Jehudimez the third, and the mummy of Jehudimez the third in the center. Jehudimez the fourth. See? Now, can't you see what happens when they keep turning these black bodies over? You got to get a new explanation. You got to say, well, they used to be white. See? Used to be white when they lived. That's why Sheikh Abdul Diab went into this melanin dosage thing, because if they were black when they lived, melanin is still there because it don't break down. Amenhotep the second, grandfather of King Tutankhamun. How you like this, sister? Anutawi, high priestess of Amun at Waset in the 18th dynasty. High priestess. Nappy head high priestess. If you could see the real picture of this with the nice, detail on it, you could even see that she got same trouble with the kitchen that all of us have. Queen. Okay, Queen T, Amenhotep the third. This is the father of King Tutankhamun. Somebody asked, how do you know it's the father? John Jackson points out that there's a red lion in the British Museum, and on the side of it, it's an inscription by King Tutankhamun saying, my father was Amenhotep the third. That makes him the brother of Pharaoh Akhenaten. So this is the father and the mother, the Queen T, at the peak of the rule of Kemet in the world. This is when they were world power. Here is King Amenhotep III, Queen T, and then here is Queen T. Because she was the woman who ruled while her husband sat on the throne. Foreign kings wrote letters to her asking for whatever it was they wanted, because she was the power behind the throne, Queen T. Amenhotep, son of Hapu, the president of the University of Iperisut. He was the chief of the royal scribe. That's what his title was. This is Akhenaten. Picture of Akhenaten. This is fake Nefertiti. This is true Nefertiti. And this is the family portrait. The mother-in-law, the son, the daughter-in-law, and the other son. We believe that's her son, too. But certainly that's at least her stepson, King Tutankhamun's golden man. So you have family portrait. That's what we mean by putting things in context. Okay? Okay, the daughters, they were trying to explain these away by talking about their head shape, and those of you who've seen this before know that that's very typical African head shape. No matter where you go on the continent of Africa or in Dallas. Okay, here's the last one. The mummy of King Tutankhamun. His mask. His image drawn by white people in the Los Angeles Times. His image drawn by white people to put in the video arcade. That's why the Egyptian culture attaché is confused. Seti I, the mummy of the father of Ramesses II. So even if you can't get to Ramesses, daddy's black. Then the carving of Ramesses II outside the temple of Luxor. And then under the Aswan, behind the waters of under the waters behind Aswan Dam at Abu Simbel, Ramesses II being lifted, and they are put back together at Abu Simbel, going down into the temple with Ramesses II sitting back there on the right hand of God. And then I'll end with this one picture here, which brings us up to today. This is one you probably haven't seen. This is a book that was done by Anwar Sadat's daughter on the life of Anwar Sadat. And it just happens to be a family portrait of Anwar Sadat that illustrates the point I was trying to make to you before, which is there's been a whole lot of mixing. And if you walk through Egypt today, you'll still see the results of it, just like you see it in Sadat's family. First, you'll see Sadat's father, and then you'll see the black lady there. That's Sadat's mother. Now you know why they had to pick who they picked to play Sadat in the movie, don't you? You know, and they tell me that there's a whole lot more to this than we have time to go into right now. Clearly speaking, if we want to get the truth, we have to go back to the source. And what the source means, going back to original data, organizing that by time, organizing that by context. And if we do that, we will liberate this information again for the use of our people. Thank you.